Hello, I'm Cheuk. Welcome to my talk. I don't know whether you have heard about Trojan source code. It's a way of attacking malicious software that is discovered by a researcher last year. It is a big thing. It has shaken the whole open source community. And a lot of maintainers are aware of this. Since this Trojan source code does not only affect the Python code, but I am a Python user, so I will just talk about this in my own perspective as a Python user. Here you can also find my contact details, like my website or my social media on Twitter. So feel free to connect with me and then talk more about this if you really want to discuss in detail. So before I start opening all these amazing things about Trojan source, I would like to give you a an exercise to think about what's wrong in this code. So it looks very straightforward. It is, you know, just hello world. Just print the hello world. What's wrong? You may think, well, there must be something hidden, right? You're tricking me. No, actually, I don't. I would show you this. So this is a online Python interpreter. So I'll just paste the code here and run. Hello world, it works. There's no trickery in here. Yay. Did I fool you? Okay, so that's what it is, right? So now, can you tell me about this one? What's wrong with this one, right? You may think, well, you can't trick me two times, right? So there's nothing wrong in here, right? Because everything looks exactly the same. You know, if you compare them like bit by bit, it looks exactly the same, right? What's wrong? So I'm going to show you what can be wrong. So let me run this, and there is an error, and there is an invalid character. So, okay. Something very, very fishy going on here. This is just a small demonstration of things can go wrong regarding Trojan source. So now we gotta dive deeper and see what's going wrong. But before that, I would like to introduce myself. So hello, I'm Cheuk. Nice to meet you. I love open source projects. I have been involved in different open source projects in the past, and I love Python events. I would love to maybe one day meet you all in person for PyCon APAC. So right now I am traveling a lot to different events. Also, I organize some online events as well. But in the pandemic, you know, I have nowhere to go, so I have too much time at home. I did stream a little bit on Twitch, but I haven't had time to do it since the world opening up again. So let's go back to the talk. Unicode is very, very weird. We all know that. We all have fun, you know, talking about it. We see all this meme online saying, like, well, sometimes my Unicode doesn't render and things doesn't look nice. Also, we have fun poking around and seeing when we can use Unicode when we are not supposed to. Like, for example, this is my friend. He is showing in a live stream talk that you could import pandas as pandas emoji. You can absolutely do that. It may not be very easy to code, but it's a lot of fun doing that. And, you know, next time you may send your code to have a peer review and people see, oh, there's pandas emoji, and it may make them smile. Unicode may be more than just fun. When it got started, actually, it's very ambitious. It's trying to handle the world's writing system. So we all know that when computers started, we only have ASCII characters, and they are just characters that is used, you know, for English language. If the language is only English, it's probably going to be enough to just use ASCII characters. But when computer getting more and more popular and more common, so there needs to have the computer to handle different languages, not just European languages, but also languages around the world. So you can see this coming, right? Like, this is a not easy task because some language can look very, very different from English. So that's why Unicode is kind of like become more and more complicated and it's a huge set of characters. Some of them is not even used as a character. They're used as a functional characters. So what it means is that they are mostly invisible and it just functions as some instructions for the computer. So bidirectional character, which we would go into, would be one of them. It's just the instructions to tell the computer when it display a sentence, a paragraph, how should the character be displayed. So Unicode is actually not a new thing. It's date back to 1991. So do you have memory of the early 90s? Or were you born after the 90s? Then you will have no memories of it. So the most popular one is UTF-8. There are other UTF as well, but I think most of them that you encounter will be UTF-8. It just means that using, it bytes to show a character. And of course, you can double it to become UTF-16, but that's less popular. For the Chinese character, actually, it's not even UTF. There are different protocols for Chinese characters. But I am not going to dive into it because we will spend more than just 30 minutes to talk about it. We will spend maybe half of a day to talk about it. So let's not dive too deep into this. So one thing that I want to mention is something that we all know and love is emoji. Emoji now is very, very, very popular. It's in your phone, is in social media, computer, and like I just showed you, you can use it in Python code if you don't mind the trouble of typing emojis. Then mainly actually, do we remember when we start using emojis? So actually, most of them are added in 2014. So I remember before that, when we send message to friends, we just use some symbols to maybe type a smiley face or a laughing face and face like that, or a frowning face, you know. But yeah, the emoji that we love actually is quite modern. Let's be a little bit more serious and talk about bidirectional characters. So like I said before, it's a functional character. So it's mainly used to handle languages that are actually not from left to right. So English and most of the European languages, they are from left to right. But of course, there are languages that are not always written from left to right. A few of them that I can think of would be Arabic and Hebrew. They are from right to left. But our computer, the default is from left to right, just like our code. When we code, we expect things to be from left to right. But because we have to deal with, all different kind of languages, so that's why we have these bidirectional characters, that when a computer scan to this character, and the computer will know that what will be the sequence of displaying the next character. So for example, one of the bidirectional character would tell the cursor. So when you type an article, right? Let's say on the document, you type an article, it's from left to right, your cursor go from left to right. When you press enter, it go to the next line. If it happens to be a bidirectional character in it, the cursor would jump to the end of that line, and then all the characters that you type will actually be inserted the left to the previous one. So the order has been flipped, and is the function of that character. So you can think it's on purpose. It works well if you have a language that reads from right to left, because, you know, what's following this character is the one on the left for that language. So it makes sense for that language. So it's controlling the flows of text. But why we talk about it? Because if we use them in code, strange things can happen. We already established that you can use Unicode in Python, right? Like, you know, you can import pandas as panda emoji. That's because you can use Unicode in Python. Also, there's another lightning talk that I think James Pyle did, that he used Chinese characters as the variable names. That's legitimate. You can do that if you want to. So using Unicode in Python is not a new thing. But if you use a bidirectional character in the code on purpose, then it could create some problem. If you just made a mistake, then it's very obvious that you can spot that, you know, why all these characters are flipped, there must be a mistake there and you can fix it. But not all of them are mistakes. Some of them are purposefully added there to make the code look legitimate. But actually, the code itself is doing things that is different from what it appears to be. That's why it caused a problem. And that's why it's a Trojan source malware is something that deceives you. So Trojan source, actually the name has come from Trojan horse. So I don't know whether you have heard about this story. I think I heard about it kind of when I was a kid. It's a very well-known story. I don't know whether it's true. Did it really happen? But there was an ancient time, I think in Greek, if I remember correctly, there are cities that are fighting each other. I can't remember the premise of it, but what it happens is that there were some soldiers occupying the city. They successfully occupying the city, and there the enemy is trying to take the city, and they're outside, right? They try to come in and conquer this, but they can't get in. The defense was too fierce, and so they have to they just can't get in this city. So someone come up with a brilliant idea, let's just declare defeat and let the conqueror of the city celebrate inside, right? They can celebrate because, you know, they've defend the city and it's theirs now. It's like, well, and so, you know, the enemy just declared defeat and then they can celebrate. And while they're celebrating, there is a gift that got delivered to them. And it's this beautiful horse that is built by wood, right? So the occupier of the city, they were like so happy, they thought they win, and then they just like, oh yeah, gift. Well, we would just have the gift. And then they got drunk and then they were celebrating. And by the time they're all sleeping, it turns out that the enemy was hiding inside this horse. And so now the soldier came out and then they would, you know, turn the table around and win back the city. So that's the story of Trojan horse. So it's actually described the idea of Trojan source perfectly, because Trojan source code actually malicious code that was hiding in plain sight, that deceived you, that is actually in front of you and you can't see it, just like the soldier inside the horse. There are, according to the researcher, there are three types of Trojan source code. They're all well documented in the website, trojansource.codes. There are papers published there. So please, if you're interested, please go there and read the paper and see the original materials. The first type of the Trojan source code are early returns. So it's demonstrated in the paper with this Python code. So this is what it looks like in the code. So it looks legitimate. If someone made a contribution like this, you kind of, you know, it's a nice contribution. There is a function. There is a doc string with the function. Wow, like how often a function come with a doc string, you know. There's someone like me, you know, I can't, you know, I'm lazy. Sometimes I don't write doc strings, right? So this is really good, right? Except that there's something hidden. There is a bidirectional character that got hidden there that you can see. By changing the direction of things, and the order of things, I would say, the returns is actually for outside of the doc string. So what does it mean? It means that after this function, you know, and the doc string, it immediately go to a return because semicolon act as a enter in Python. So it just immediately return. Once a function got returned, none of the code follow would be executed. So as you can see here, the function, main function of this function, hasn't been executed, right? So the amount hasn't been deducted with this code. So it doesn't do what it actually need to be doing. So it's a malicious code. It's wrong. So that's the early return, is to force a function to exit the execution earlier than what is supposed to be. So the second type is commenting out. So this is demonstrated with the C code here. So in the C code, or the comment, you know, quote with this slash thing. So these are the comments. So again, looks very legitimate. There are comments, you know, like all the good code is need to be commented. And there's this check of the if there. So you can already guess, right? Something is wrong. And yes, this one is more complicated. They actually involve multiple bidirectional characters. That by, again, shifting the order of things, the if course that check whether some, you know, someone has the admin right is being pushed inside the comments. So the check didn't really happen. And in this case, it only prints out that you are an admin. But if you really carry something out that only admin can do, then it may be wrong and it may create some problem here. So that's another example. That's called commenting out. Very straightforward. The last example here is called strange strings. Very, very similar idea of commenting out. It's demonstrated here in this code, I believe, is in JavaScript. So here, so again, there's some comment involved, as always. But this time, instead of pushing something inside a comment, we do it the other way around. We alternate the if check by alternating the strings. So in here, you see with a very careful, again, planning of the bidirectional character, you can put what looks like the comment inside the string. And now the string is not what is supposed to be. And again, this changes the whole logic of the code and would create problems. So those are the three types of the Trojan source code that was explained in the paper. In the paper, I also mentioned a few other different similar exploitation using the very interesting characters of Unicode. For example, a lot of Unicodes are actually invisible. So by incorporating some invisible characters, you can make the code go a little bit crazy. There's also monographs that, which is just a fancy term for characters that looks exactly the same, but they're not the same. So the homographs example is here. This one, I believe, is in C. In Python, it will be the other way around, because in Python, the default function that got run would be the second one. But I believe in C is the other way around. So the first one is the one that's supposed to be if all these three colored H are the same. So if you look at it without the coloring, you would just expect that, oh, hello world will be executed. But because these two are different, you will see that actually only the second one will be registered and it's actually goodbye world. So again, it's a way of using the very funny nature of Unicode to deceive our eyes that actually the program is doing something that that we are not expecting, because that's not what it looks like. So there are a few things that work in Python. I won't go into the detail. They are all in the this GitHub repository here. It shows what works, what doesn't work in Python. Actually, if we have a quick look of it, then it have a few examples here. For example, the homographs function, it kind of worked this way. You know, you thought it's the second one, hello world, but actually it's the goodbye world that got registered because these characters are the same. So with the coloring, you can quite easily figure it out, but without, it would be puzzling. The other things, you know, for example, the commenting hours, you can see, actually, this is quite nice that GitHub would warn you if there's a bidirectional character inside the code. So you can see this, it's already flagging this problem out for you. So these have been tested in mainly Python 3.7 and 3.9 on different, operating systems. But, you know, now we are moving, you know, most people are using, well, I won't say most people, but a lot of people are using 3.10 already. Also, Python 3.11 is coming out soon. So if you're interested to test it out in newer version of Python, good for you. Please do that. And if you discover anything new, please alert the community. We really appreciate that. So what should we do? Shall we be really worrying? And shall actually we ban the use of bidirectional character? I would say the developers, especially C Python developers, they are aware of this. And there are already discussions and precaution that was carrying out. I can't say for them, so I won't go into that direction for the discussion. But as a user myself, there are things that something we can do. For example, we should be more responsible of our own code. When you do coding, use a good text editor that have the syntax highlighting that will warn you if there's a bidirectional character. For example, the example on GitHub is already showing that. And I'm sure a lot of modern IDE, they also do that. So it will already scan the invisible characters. So I think most of them do. It's actually very difficult for me to find that online interpreter that I showed you at the beginning of the talk that doesn't show the bidirectional character that I was planted there. Actually, it's more difficult to fool people than actually finding it. So, also a good linter will flag up all the problems. For example, the homograph attack that actually, if you lint it, then, PyLint will tell you, well, one of them hasn't been used. So, you know, the code smells a bit fishy, right? So a linter will tell you if there's a problem, which is good. So the last piece of advice for me is that, because I am that person, right? I do copy code from online sources, Stack Overflow, GitHub, and a lot of different places, tutorials. I do copy and run code sometimes just to test things out, just to see if it works or not. But look before you run the code. Like I said, if you have a good text editor, even if you're just pasting it, and by looking at what you paste on it, it already flag up all the problems. Then you already, can look out the fishy code. even better, you just lean the code before you run it, before you publish anything. You know, a good CI pipeline of deploying anything should include a lot of tests and a lot of linting. So that would also safeguard your project if you're publishing it. Look, before you run the code, we should be responsible for any code that we run and publish. So last thing, we all love Unicode and emojis. It's a lot of fun working with them. But we also need to be very careful about, you know, sometimes it has been used with a, you know, bad intention. So just be more careful, be a responsible Python user. Check the code that you found from any questionable source. It's difficult to trust people online and also in open source. But, you know, we are part of the community. We want to safeguard this trust. So that's why we have to all be responsible and look out for those malicious code and also protect our own products from those malicious code. So thank you so much for listening to me. If you want to know more, please visit the original website, the trojansource.co. I don't take credit for any of these things that I tell you about. They are found by a lot of researcher, and it's a very nice discovery. And then thank you for them to discovering it, and thank you that I can share this with you today. I hope you enjoyed it, and I hope you enjoy the rest of the conference.